Hey, Musical Minds listeners, it's Eric here. I am super excited. I am about to go into an interview with Cory Hall of the Bach Scholar. He has Bach Scholar on YouTube at 70,000 subscribers and then BachScholar.com. And so he's made his entire brand around classical music and more specifically Bach music. And so I'm super excited to have him on the show. I've been watching his YouTube channel for about a year and a half, and I reached out to him and he was so kind to offer an interview. So I'm really excited for this. I'm really hoping to get a lot of the musicology that comes from Bach and know Bach a little bit better as a person. And hopefully that'll translate into better interpretations with his playing. And then also I'd like to delve into what it takes just being a professional musician and a high-performing musician. So I'm super excited for this interview. If you're enjoying this show, if you do enjoy this show, because it is a free podcast, if I could just ask you to go over to iTunes, subscribe to the podcast, leave a review or comment, an honest review. That way I just know that somebody else is listening and somebody's benefiting from this. And if you're a musician and say you're in school or a conservatory or know other musicians and you think that this might benefit them, please share it with them because that really helps with visibility and helps me sustain the motivation to just continue reaching out to these people, generating this content. So thank you so much for tuning in. This has been a long-winded intro. And please enjoy my interview with Cory Hall of the Bach Scholar. Hello, and welcome to the Musical Minds podcast, where it is our job to flesh out the mindset and ways to cope with the struggles that ensue in becoming a high-performing musician. Hosted by Eric Reinhardt and Jake Pietranero. Now let's get on to the show. We're live with the Musical Minds podcast, and I have with me today Cory Hall of the Bach Scholar YouTube channel. So welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
So, nice to be here. Yeah. So why don't we start off with just so we can get to know you a little bit, who you are and the mission that you have at Bach Scholar.
Great. Well, that's a good question. As many of you know, who have been following me for a while on YouTube, I own the Bach Scholar YouTube channel, and which has become very popular, one of the most popular classical YouTube channels. I began this in 2008. I actually acquired this nice Steinway here in 2006, and I was in a Steinway store. Wasn't planning on buying a piano. I had a pretty nice upright before this, and I was in the store, and I ended up in a couple days later. I had acquired a loan. let's just say it was a loan that would be equivalent to a really nice car.
Yeah,
I had a 10-year loan on this piano in 2006, and so I acquired this piano in 2006. So that's about when YouTube was invented.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, YouTube, for those young people out there, YouTube's been around for their whole life. But there was a time when YouTube didn't exist, and I began, watching YouTube videos, getting into it. A friend of mine introduced me to YouTube in 2006,
mm-hmm.
and it was very young then. Not a lot of videos, but there were some piano videos. Started watching the videos and I thought, wow, this is really interesting. I have this really nice piano. What am I ever going to do with this piano but practice by myself in my living room? So I thought, well, gosh, I want to jump on the bandwagon. So I guess a couple years later, it was 2008. I finally, got the nerve up to buy a video camera and a microphone. And I actually had some really, really nice photography lights. I had the whole setup.
Mm-hmm.
So I started making YouTube videos in 2008. And my very first videos were the 15 two-part inventions by Bach, very famous. I can't even believe, you know, when I think back, I must have been crazy because I recorded all of those in one night, all memorized. You know, I for many years and teaching them, but I practiced them especially hard for several weeks and got them all ready. And I don't know, you know, I should have spaced them out over a week or so, but I spent the whole night up until about 3 a.m. recording all of the 15 two-part inventions. This was in September of 2008, and I uploaded. I was really excited. Oh, you know, my adrenaline went up. Wow, I have my videos. And then, you know, I quickly started gaining a following, a big following of people who wanted to, you know, who liked my videos. And I guess the rest is history. You know, I just started just uploading things that I like to play, Bach and ragtime, of course, which I'm famous for, and other, you know, just standard piano things. So it was a hobby then. I had that time in 2008. I was employed at two colleges. I was teaching part-time at two colleges, and I was a church organist. So I had three jobs, driving here and there and everywhere, getting speeding tickets everywhere I was going. I was in a hurry to drive to this college, drive to that college, drive to the church where I was organist. And so it was a hectic life. And then in my free time, at that time I was not married or no kids or anything. So I all my free time was devoted to just making videos. So the years 2008, 2009, 2010, up till about 2012, I was pretty much just, you know, just a single guy, just having fun making videos in my free time. And and I sort of made a system out of my making my videos. And I was always a perfectionist, always striving for perfection. Just uploading videos. And then, you know, I started acquiring an even larger following. And then in 2012, actually around 2011, I I had the Bach Scholar YouTube channel already. And then in 2011, I actually created my LLC, which is called Bach Scholar Publishing. I decided, well, you know, I'm going to start publishing sheet music. And so I got some good software and started, you know, learning to write out sheet music and selling some sheet music. And actually, it wasn't until 2012 when BachScholar.com actually, I think BachScholar.com was going already, but it was to promote my tempo theory in Bach. Which I originally, that's why I call myself Bach Scholar on YouTube, was to promote my tempo theory, especially in the Bach inventions that I had uploaded first in 2008. Well, anyway, so I started branching out, doing things other than Bach. You know, I don't want to just play Bach, and sometimes even I get tired of playing Bach. So then comes 2012, and my website, BachScholar.com, I began to use as my business website. So I began teaching, I began advertising for teaching piano via Skype and selling sheet music. So I began that in September of 2012. And I gradually sort of picked up a following of, gradually picked up students who wanted to study with me. It took about a year until I had a good enough students to where I could do that full time and, you know, pay all my bills and not do anything else. So by that time, by around the end of 2013, or actually 2012, I had resigned from all my jobs. And I was 100% self-employed. So no more colleges, no more church organ. I was fully 100% self-employed, teaching piano via Skype to students all over the world. And today, 5 years later, it's now I've been doing this 5 years, and I have a waiting list about 6 months long. for students. I teach about 50 students weekly now, all over the world, from Australia, Norway, Hong Kong. I've had students everywhere in the South Pacific. I've had students everywhere in the corner of the globe, which is quite flattering. And I think it's highly enjoyable. I've, you know, now that I'm sort of in the middle age stage of life, I finally have achieved what I believe is my niche. My niche now, my mission is to, now more than ever, is to offer the world what I have to offer in music. I have so many facets of music and piano that a lot of people don't know about. I'm an expert in music theory. I also have a master's degree in music history. Of course, piano, ragtime, Bach. You know, I do a lot of things, a lot of things that most, your average piano teacher doesn't do.
Mm-hmm.
And I need to offer these to the world. So my next website is in process right now. It's called wellroundedpianist.com.
Hmm.
www.wellroundedpianist.com, and it's going to be a subscription site. It's now April. It will probably go live in June or July, and it will have even more than what YouTube has right now.
Hmm.
I'm going to offer in-depth tutorials and lessons, and which won't be available on YouTube. And I can use that to finally offer the world all the knowledge I have in all the areas I have. I can't do that with all my students on a weekly basis on mm-hmm. Skype. So I really feel like I have to do this in order to branch out, to offer my services to the whole world. So it will be a subscription site for the price of a few cups of coffee a month. People will be able to join and get information from all these videos. And also, I may, in fact, I'm planning on bringing in other specialists who are specialties in other areas that I'm not good at, like jazz, for example, or other areas of music. I may invite to come in and have them come on board. So this is a new business venture of mine that I'm working on right now, in addition to BachScholar.com. So my mission, as you asked me, is basically to just spread my knowledge throughout the world to those people who want to play piano and reap the benefits of my knowledge and furthering their education. I think I have a lot to offer. And since I am not in the traditional college or university atmosphere, you know, I'm not employed by an institution.
Mm-hmm.
I can do whatever I want. I can spread my knowledge far and wide. I don't have to worry about committees. I don't have to worry about peer review. I don't have to worry about anything. I can do whatever I want. And it's really quite exciting right now for me, because it took 5 years for me to really build up a following to where I actually have a waiting list now.
Mm.
And you know, where I'm not, I'm not scrounging around wondering how am I going to pay my next bills. So I love the, finally now at this stage of my life, I've hit my niche.
Yeah.
Professionally in what I want to do. And it took a long time. You know, a lot of my peers are already all practically ready to retire from their university posts. You know, I'm just starting.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
So it's like I feel I need to make up for lost time and offer my services to the whole world through YouTube, which is, of course, free, BachScholar.com, which offers piano lessons via Skype, which is lessons with me, and also my wife Marilyn teaches piano too.
Mm-hmm.
And sheet music with Bach Scholar Publishing, and the new website wellroundedpianist.com, which is going live in a couple months. So anyway, that's pretty long-winded. I hope I answered a lot of your questions through that.
Yeah, that actually arose several more questions, and then also just like there's a lot of taking away points. It's going to take a lot of time. It's going to take more time than you want it to build anything. And for me, that's been a pain point of just like wanting that instant gratification, like instant followership and listenership and gaining traction. And actually one of my goals is to be less more geographically free, through being able to teach online. That gives you a lot of freedom. I love that paradigm that you've established. And then also just bringing education and bringing piano education, music education to more of a private sector and driving, like that drives competition, which overall improves the overall quality of music education rather than like a bureaucratic type of conservatory type of organization. And I love that you're able to do these things because you're not constrained.
Exactly. And I totally agree with that. And I couldn't agree with that more. You know, it's funny, when I first got out of graduate school with I hold a doctorate in piano from the University of Kansas. And when I first finished way back in 1994 with my doctorate, I was, you know, my goal was to get a university job. Mm-hmm. To get a professorship somewhere. Well, I had a hard time doing that because the competition is really tough. So, I was happy just eventually to get these two part-time jobs in these colleges where I taught 11 years. And then I thought, well, gosh, you know, I can do so much more than this. It is very bureaucratic. Like you said, it's very bureaucratic. It's very political. I think I wasn't hired for many political reasons,
mm-hmm.
Affirmative action and that kind of thing, but other reasons I won't go into that sort of, you know, I had to create my own job,
mm-hmm.
and my creation was Bach Scholar, which just last year I received the registered trademark, the R for mm-hmm. Bach Scholar. So, now my next venture is to do more with Bach Scholar Publishing. Now that I have the registered trademark and I've sort of perfected my style, my system for sheet music. So my next venture is, my next stage in this business is to create hard copy publications, not digital. I've been doing digital publications for 5 years. Now I want to get into hard copy publications on Amazon, for example. And my sight reading book, which is the next question I'll answer, is the first step towards that goal. Mm-hmm. So my sight reading book called Sight Reading and Harmony is it evolved actually over several years, but it really came into full fruition about last year. Or the beginning of this year, but actually last year, in 2016. And it's based on a system I developed and that has gradually increasing complexities.
Mm-hmm.
It's four-part chorales. First of all, I discovered that first and foremost, sight reading is probably the weakest area in most pianists' education. I get more pianists emailing me and messaging me about sight reading issues than any other issue. I think sight reading and fingering, for some reason, have to be the two probably most pressing issues that most pianists are facing. When I say pianists, I mean not professional pianists who are playing concerts. I would say 80% of my audience is intermediate level pianist. Actually, probably 60% of my audience, 60% of my private students happen to be of the baby boomer generation, 50 years older. I have many students 50 years and older. So we're not talking about kids. I do have kids and I teach kids as well. But it's really a unique time in history right now where you have this over glut of baby boomers who now are retiring or reaching retirement age, and they want to pursue their where they left off when they were kids. So they started piano when they were kids, maybe in the 50s or 60s, and now they're retired, they're semi-retired, and they want to pursue that again. And where do they turn? Well, they turn to me. I'm really in high demand among that, for that age group.
Yeah.
For adult beginners and adults who can play already and want to continue where they left off 30 years ago.
Yeah. That's so awesome that you know your audience.
It is my audience. Actually, the average age of all my 50 students is 33.
Okay. Average. Nice.
So we're not talking, I think 30 or 40 years ago, most piano teachers, the average age was maybe 10 years old.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Right now, my youngest student is 7 or 8. She just turned 8. My youngest student is 8. And bear in mind, these are all Skype students, so I don't teach anyone live in my home. My youngest student is 8. My oldest student is 82. So I have an 82-year-old lady that lives in rural Idaho who takes from me as well. She's been taken actually for about 4 years now. So my piano students range from age 8 to 82. The average age is 33. I would say 60% of my students are 40 to 60 years old. So now getting back to sight reading, because I wanted to bring that up. Sight reading is the weakest area for all piano students, I've noticed. It's very rare that you find pianists who sight read well, actually. And it doesn't have to be that way. It doesn't have to be that way. It depends on the early training and how you're trained. Now, my sight reading book is very unique and special in that it is based on a system I developed of increasing complexities in Bach's Park Rouse. Now, the first line is very easy, grades 1 and 2. So ideally, the student would want to focus on that, beginning students and even more advanced students who are very weak in sight reading need to focus just on that line. That's the foundation of all of sight reading, because it uses what music theorists call first species counterpoint. That was a term that was used in the 1700s that in which one note in the right hand or treble clef is posed against one note in the left hand bass clef, and they move together, they change together. Now, this is different from the normal chord in the left hand, just simple chord in the left hand and melody in the right hand.
Mm-hmm.
Most piano method books are based upon that system, to where you're playing a chord in the left hand and a melody in the right hand.
Mm-hmm.
Problem with that is you don't learn to read equally well in both hands.
Right.
You learn by rote the chords in the left hand and you learn a melody in the right. It's really you're only learning halfway. By learning first species counterpoint, like in my sight reading book, you have to learn voice against voice, note against note, right hand and left hand notes move simultaneously. And this was the way the music was taught in the 1700s and 1800s. So anyone from Bach through any composer in the 1800s who learned composing and performing learned first species counterpoint. This was the way everyone learned. And because of this, I'm willing to bet my money, and I can't prove it, of course, but I'm willing to bet all my money that Bach, Mozart, Beethoven, Schubert, Liszt, all the great composers from 1700s onwards were superior sight readers to what most students are today.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't just because of their genius, and it was because they were brought up in a different fashion. They were weaned on first species counterpoint. And so first species counterpoint is the foundation of my sight reading system. Mm-hmm. Once you graduate from that level, then you go on to second species counterpoint, which is one note against two notes.
Mm-hmm.
So usually one note in the right hand, two notes in the left hand. And with every note that changes in the right hand, you have two notes to play in the left hand.
But
not at the same time, but one after another.
To elaborate on that, there's third species counterpoint, which is triplets.
Yeah, there is, but it really stops for this system. It's only going to stop around at two.
Okay.
There is third and fourth, but we don't really go into that because that's the ultimate foundation of it is first and second species. Then after that, then we're going to start to play vertically, align notes vertically to where you can read three notes at once and then four notes at once.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's the end. Four notes at once with notes in between is the very end. So you have first species counterpoint, second species counterpoint, then you have chords. It's really is like first species counterpoint, but you have three notes at the same time instead of two.
Yeah.
You're expanding it to three notes at once. It would be like playing playing a bass note here and play an alto note and a soprano note here. That's three voices right there.
Right.
So see that most students who learn sight reading or most beginning piano students do not learn to read three or four notes at once. It's very rare that they learn that. And they don't learn it soon enough. And so I'm preparing the foundation for that through the very first line in my sight reading book. And it's a book that will, if followed correctly, if one really focuses on the first line of each page, 150 examples, and then only goes to the second line after they've graduated from that.
Mm.
And then only go to the third line after you've graduated from the second line of the 150 examples, that it really will definitely improve people's sight reading 100%. Mm. Because it has a foundation in it that no other piano methods have.
Mm.
Bach harp chorales really are the pinnacle of musical harmony.
Mm-hmm.
In the Western world, in Western music. The pinnacle of harmony in Western music. They've never been outdone. They've never been better. And for that reason, I believe Bach's four part chorales are actually the most efficient and the best pieces to improve sight reading.
Mm-hmm.
But the problem is that the unchanged versions are so difficult for most people to sight read, especially beginners and intermediate level, that I had to do something. I had to simplify them.
Yeah.
So it's a simplified, very simplified chorale with just the skeleton. Then each step gets a little more complex until you reach the final version.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I actually watched the YouTube video that you have on your channel that kind of outlines that and you going through each one. And I think that's addressing a common pain point that a lot of people have of just sort of this feeling of directionless repertoire. Whereas in your system, I think there's something inherently satisfying about going from level one to level two to level three and feeling like you can definitely see progress and notice progress.
Definitely.
And what is that on the system, like the graded system? Is that like Royal Conservatory of Music?
Well,
levels?
My grade, the way I grade these isn't necessarily based on any contemporary system. Mine is it's sort of internally graded. So they're not, so my grade three isn't necessarily the same as grade three for the Royal Conservatory or ABRSM. but mine is internally consistent. So all the pieces in my book, the grade one, are of similar difficulty. And all of the ones that are grade eight are of similar difficulty. And so internally within my book, the grades are consistent. But it really, it's not, grading things isn't really an exact science. So it's very difficult to, say it's an exactly the same difficulty.
Mm-hmm.
Like my grade three in a Bach chorale is exactly the same difficulty as a grade three for ABRSM. That's difficult to do. It's almost impossible. But within its own system, it has a consistency within the system that is very attractive. And it's going to work. It will work very well with teachers, with students. Teachers who want a structured approach to teaching,
mm-hmm,
can't do it better than getting my sight reading book and using it on their students. That's what I'm making it for. I'm making it for teachers to use on their students. Of course, there's a lot of self-learners that don't have teachers, and they can use it as well. But to really get the most out of it, it's really going to work the best with a qualified teacher who knows, who can demonstrate them to the students and know and be able to assign the right ones to students and know how the progressions go up.
Yeah.
So my goal in this book is to have it in every teacher's studio. I think every teacher, every piano teacher should have one.
Hmm.
And I'm not just saying that just so they'll buy my book. I'm saying that because it is a very important systematic book on sight reading that all teachers should have in their studio. Definitely. I'm really excited about it. It's still in progress. I mean, it's about 90% completed, 90 to 95% completed right now. It's still organizing things and putting finishing touches on things. But it belongs in every teacher's studio. And any piano student who is serious about sight reading should get the book. Also, it gets even better. It's not just for individual teachers. It's also for colleges and universities, for piano classes. So it serves really a multitude of purposes. It can be used in college and university piano classes.
Yeah.
It can be used in for private piano teachers, for the students. It can be used for self-learners. It can be used for ear training, for music theory, for learning what the chords are called and things. I offer a little chart on each page that shows the chords that are used in each of the excerpts. So it really has a lot of functions I'm really excited about. Most books don't have that many functions. Mm-hmm. This has a lot of functions, and it's a highly useful book that's also going to feature some exercises and chord progression exercises. And I also have major and minor scales of all the fingerings. So I'm really excited and looking forward to this. Sight reading and harmony.
In an ideal world, so I've been finding with my students that giving them very specific prescriptions, especially for young kids, of like, you have to do this three times. In an ideal world, would you have the student in this weekly lesson paradigm be like, I want you to do three new sight reading exercises from this book each day? Or
they're so short, they're only one line each.
Yeah.
So you can easily do three a day.
Yeah.
And repetition is key. So I would suggest that if you were to get the book, if it were published and you had it, you would go through that line. You can go through it, I'd say, at least four times.
Mm-hmm.
Repetition is good. So go through it about four times where you really get used to reading that passage, and then just go to the next page.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Or you can jump around. They're not in any particular order. They're in alphabetical order,
right,
by their German titles. So, you can just jump around, but you can jump around anywhere you want, but stay on that one line.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Until you've graduated from that one line. Now, the way you graduate from it is your teacher or someone else other than you will pick at least 10 of those, from, and preferably with different key signatures. So maybe one with no sharps or flats, one with one sharp, one with one flat, one with two sharps, one with two flats. Maybe, the teacher can select, I would say 10, at the most 10, at the least 5 of these, and then select those. And then if the student can actually play those through from beginning to end with no mistakes at a consistent tempo, a slow but consistent speed, and they can do that with all those examples, then they've graduated from that level.
Mm.
Then they move on to the next level. If they can't do that, if they fumble around and just can't do it yet, well, they need to prove it.
Yeah.
They haven't graduated from it yet. They can't move on to the next level.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a really, I don't want to sound negative about it, but there are piano students who will really just never make it to the grade 9 and 10. That they just, some students will always be stuck on grades 3 and 4. And that's just the way it is. It's not a quick fix.
Mm-hmm.
It's not an easy thing. You have to work hard at it. But if you do work hard and you follow the directions, and then you'll achieve, ultimately your sight reading will improve, because this will give you the skills that you'll need and the foundation you need in order to be a good sight reader. Contemporary method books don't do this. That's why most students are not very good sight readers, because the contemporary method books have totally ignored first species counterpoint. It isn't taught anymore. And there's no system with teaching students how to read vertical harmonies.
Mm-hmm.
Like hymns and chorales, church hymns and Bach chorales. No piano teachers ever teach these things. I think I'm the only one in the world that does. I mean, I don't know. I haven't found anybody. Find me another pianist that teaches Bach chorales.
Mm.
I can't find one.
How do you rationalize teaching?
They're the best things to learn.
How do you, I guess, the way I interpret it is that, like, classical music is boring. That's what a lot of people think. And so how do we engage the student to really want to do this? I think a lot of teachers would like to do it, but they're just afraid of losing their student or making the student disinterested. Do you have any thoughts on that?
Well, yeah, I've heard that a lot. Classical music is boring. I've heard that, Beethoven always sounds the same. well, of course, Beethoven's Fifth Symphony always sounds the same every time you listen to it. just like if you read a book, if you read The Catcher in the Rye, it's going to be the same every time you read it, right?
The content,
they're
yeah.
The same word. So, I know what they're saying, but that's not true. I can say it about any style of music.
Yeah.
I can say it about rap music or hip hop or pop music. Pop music always sounds the same. I mean, you can say that about anything. That just depends on your orientation.
Yeah.
With how you've been raised. But classical music, well, that's why there's such a wide range of composers.
Uh-huh.
It doesn't sound all the same. Debussy's Clair de Lune, to me, sounds much different than a Bach four-part chorale.
Uh-huh. I'm not the naysayer. I love classical music.
I know you are good people. Potential listeners to this podcast will Well, you know, they're entitled to their beliefs. They can say that if they want, but I disagree. And piano, if you take piano, if you start studying piano, you'll discover how many rich styles of music there are within the classical music genre.
It's definitely a rabbit hole.
Classical music, I see why they say that. You know, classical music sounds the same, but, you know, it's sort of, after you've studied it a long time, it becomes laughable, actually. All right, do you have any more questions?
Yeah, I'd like to get in one more. I know that we're coming up on your time, and I just want to be respectful of your time because it sounds like you're a busy person.
If you want to get this down to 45 minutes, that's fine. No, I still have a little time. So
I'm okay going longer term, but I...
Yeah, you can go long. Yeah, you can go longer.
Okay. Sure. So something that I just want to understand... I want to just kind of go off of this graded level concept that you're doing. And mm-hmm. for me, understand the hierarchy of of Bach's music as far as like a level system. So I think my interpretation is that it's like 2-part inventions, then 3-part, and then the well-tempered clavichord. Am I missing anything?
No, generally speaking, that's the way that most people understand the progression, but it's really it's more complicated. Well, it's really more simple than that. Bach wrote his music for the recreation of the mind.
Mm.
Okay. That means that he wrote his music not necessarily for the concert hall or for any particular function. You know, sometimes he had functions for his music, like his cantatas or church cantatas or a mass or something like that. But his instrumental music, like his keyboard music, is just written for the enjoyment of the player, of the student. And 2-part inventions, yeah, because they have two voices, they're seem a little easier than 3-part inventions, but not really so. I don't think the 2-part inventions are necessarily less difficult to play than most of the 3-part inventions. Because they're more exposed. The 2-part inventions, you only hear 2 parts. So if you mess up, if you make mistakes, it's more immediately noticeable,
mm-hmm.
more than if you have more voices. So if you have a 4-voice fugue, like from the well-tempered clavier, you have more notes.
Mm-hmm.
So the player can actually, you know, if they're good at disguising their mistakes, most people won't know, or the average person won't know that he made a mistake because there's more notes to deal with. It's a thicker texture.
Right.
So in a way, the 2-part inventions are more difficult because they're so thin and so exposed. And so it's very difficult to rate Bach's compositions in terms of difficulty level, because I look at it like they're all the same difficulty level, with different degrees of compositional techniques that he used.
Mm-hmm.
It's very, very difficult to rate those. I would pick some, like when I assign pieces to students, there are a certain handful of pieces in the well-tempered clavier I always assign first.
Mm-hmm.
And they're always the preludes that are 2 pages long.
Mm.
That aren't really that extensive, that don't go on forever. Like ones in book 2 are very long and very, very drawn out, very difficult. So I like to keep things, usually the shorter the piece is, the less difficult it is in Bach's terms.
Yeah, I'm working on the C minor one right now, Prelude and Fugue.
And that's good. It's an excellent one to do. That's if you want to learn a Bach fugue, that's one of the first ones you should start with.
Mm-hmm.
Is that fugue? It's hard to classify his music in terms of difficulty, but all of his music is is equal in terms of content. Mm-hmm. I don't think that Bach wasn't like a composer like Czerny. Carl Czerny composed a lot of, Czerny was a genius in the fact that he was very skilled at creating gray levels.
Yeah.
So Czerny has his beginning things, and he has his intermediate level things, and he has his advanced. He has his serious compositions. He has his exercises. So Czerny was very systematic in that way. Bach, not so. Bach didn't formulate his music with grade levels in mind. Mm-hmm. He formulated his music simply by his compositional techniques, and whether they're two voices or three voices, or whether it's a fugue, or whether it's a prelude. Preludes can be more difficult than fugues. Mm. There are preludes that are more difficult than fugues. There are some fugues that are easier than some preludes, and vice versa. So one can't really say, oh, the preludes are easier than the fugues. Uh-huh. You know, it really doesn't. You can't really say that, because they're so diverse that you can't really use that generalization. Some preludes are even fugues, like the E flat major prelude in book one of the Well-Tempered Clavier. E flat major prelude is actually a double fugue. So it's called prelude, but it's actually a fugue.
I think that comes down to people just wanting to make generalizations and just kind of somehow create structure out of this structureless entity.
Right. Well, I see that I think there's a fascination with pianists and sort of a obsession with wanting to classify everything into grade levels. And, you know, of course, I do this in my sight reading book, you know, for systematic purposes. But I'm kind of opposed to always having to do that with everything you play. Uh-huh. You know, like I'll upload a video to YouTube, and I always get someone asking, what grade level is this? Well, does it really matter?
Can you do it?
Does it really matter? You know, well, you know, the problem with that is if I say, well, it's grade level 5. Well, let's say if their teacher told them, well, you're in grade level 3. Well, they'll think, well, I can't possibly ever play it because it's 5. And I'm a 3.
Yeah.
But it doesn't work that way. Uh-huh. It's not an exact science, the way that you classify difficulties. So I would say just go for it. Just try to play it. If you're grade 3 and the piece happens to be grade 5, try it out, see if you can do it. And if you can do it, then there's a flaw in the grading system. Mm-hmm. Now, so I think that pianists are a little too overly obsessed and concerned with putting everything into categories. Mm-hmm.
Love it.
I look at it like everything is difficult. I mean, a grade 3 piece in piano can be very difficult if you play it really, really well. If you play it highly artistically, and you get all the music out of it, a grade 3 piece can actually be grade 7. Mm-hmm. If you play it really, really well and artistically. If you're only playing the notes, then a grade 3 is just a grade 3.
Mm, that comes from your, you have a 50% rule video on YouTube. I love,
yes.
I forget who said this, but it's like something along the lines of nothing ruined music more than speed.
Yeah, actually many people have said that. I know that one composer was famous for saying that, and a famous performer was, I think, George Bellette. I think the well-known pianist said that a lot, and I'm sure some composers did as well. But a grade 3 piece played at 50% tempo is really not a grade 3 piece. I mean, if a grade 3 piece, they usually grade it by the terms of its performance tempo.
Right.
So a grade three piece played at 50% tempo is really only, it should really be only grade one and a half. Mm-hmm. Because you're a lot of the criteria for grading things has to do with speed. Mm-hmm. So if you take away that speed from something, it becomes less difficult. So
right.
If somebody asks me, well, what grade is Fantasy Impromptu? Well, I guess if you play it really artistically up to tempo, it's probably grade 10. But if you play it at half speed or less than half speed, but play it well, you play it well, but only at half speed, it's probably just grade 5. Uh-huh. You know? So it really depends on how fast you play things. So it's not just the notes and the rhythms, but it has to do with other facets of the performance, whether there's pedal, how much pedal is in it, whether the pedal is used well, how fast is it? Is it a really high, really fast speed that's hard to attain for most pianists? Or is it just a moderate speed or a slow speed? So a lot of things go into the grading process. And so it's not really an exact science. And that's why I have a problem with the pianist's fascination with grade, putting everything into grade levels. Uh-huh. Because see, when I learned piano, when I started piano when I was 7 or 6, I was like 6 going on 7. I didn't think anything of grade. I was never steeped in grade levels. I just learned music. I don't ever remember being tested for grade levels. Uh-huh. I never did tests. I never did these things like ABRSM. I just learned music. And throughout my years of school, throughout high school, I just learned music. And I never even thought, it never occurred to me what grade level something's at. I just learned the music. And if you just learn the music and worry about the music, whether it's easy or hard, then that transcends the whole fascination with trying to put everything in categories.
Yeah. I love that.
Not a fan of putting things in categories like that, but except for my sight reading book, because that has to be, because it's a system of increasing complexities right. to improve your sight reading skills. So that's an exception. Mm-hmm. But in the traditional piano repertoire, it's very difficult to put labels on things. Like I say, because a grade 3 piece can easily be grade 7. And mm-hmm. if it's played badly and if it's played too slow, it's grade 3. If it's played artistically and it's played like a professional, then it's grade 7. Mm. So it depends.
Yeah, I love that. The takeaway that I'm getting is kind of really focus on the content and yes. Don't get obsessed with something that's really not that important. And really yeah. just focus on learning music in its entirety and really focusing on what's important. That's right. what I got. Yeah. Away.
And I'm sure people have encountered the same thing, like with martial arts, you know, you have your belts, you know, uh-huh. 'cause when I was younger, I used to do karate and you have white belt, you have yellow belt, you have green, whatever, going up to black. Well, I mean, a real master, a real authentic established karate master doesn't think in grades. they only think whether you can do the skills or not. So it's not a belt is just a belt.
Yeah.
That's not the essence of what you're learning. Mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah.
I mean, you know, it's like that same thing. It's the same difference in martial arts with the belt system as it is with piano with the grading system. You know, it's I guess in a way it's good to have grades, the grading system to give motivation, like especially to young kids who need motivation. Mm-hmm. But once you reach maturity, once you've reached musical maturity, it doesn't really have much value anymore, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that falls on me pretty well, since I've been hungry for this level system. So just it'll give me some right things to focus on.
Right. Now you play piano and euphonium?
Yeah, I don't play euphonium as much anymore, or I don't play it at all. After I graduated from university with a biochemistry degree and did drum corps throughout college, then I gave all my efforts to piano for that context, and really started like studying formally then. Do you have time for one more?
Sure. Yeah, one more question.
Okay, and then you can give the title of your book at the after that answer, and where people can find you. But is there so in performances by amateur pianists, is there anything that you notice as common mistakes in the performance of Bach, and or just grievances that you have with performances of Bach?
Oh, okay. And you know, it just occurred to me, you wanted to ask about dance styles, and which we never got to.
Yeah.
But maybe I'll incorporate that into this question.
Fantastic. Thank you.
Well, I think I don't think there's any big, huge problems. I think there's very often there's a misunderstanding with articulation, with whether something should be staccato or legato. And teachers, piano teachers, very often, in my opinion, don't fully understand what they're doing with their students. But I think that they like to make rules about staccato and legato. Like all eighth notes should be staccato.
That's actually something that I've heard.
Like, yeah, well, like, you know, and like, okay, we've all heard it that way, right?
Yeah.
The famous fugue you're working on. Well, why is there a rule that says we can't do this? Who says you can't play a legato?
You're playing it the Glenn Gould version.
Yeah. Who said, a break? Break. Or actually, I prefer the first one. I know I'm different than most people, but I prefer the eighth notes not staccato. Mm. I actually prefer the legato. And there's no proof Bach wanted those staccato, and there really is no justification for it. So when pianists and teachers advocate a staccato for this, there's no reason for it. I have just as much reason historically and theoretically for legato. Mm. So that it works both ways. So, you know, whenever I hear pianists play that, whenever I hear that, I think, well, they've been biased.
Mm-hmm.
Because I don't think that's what Bach wanted. I actually believe through my research that he wanted it legato and slower.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, I can't prove that 100%. But my research has led me to believe that.
Yeah.
But most pianists who play staccato don't do any research. So they're just playing it the way they hear everyone else play it. So what the point I'm trying to make is that we all have biases. We all have 20th and 21st century biases, and that we don't know about, including teachers. And in order to eliminate these biases, you have to really delve into the history, and which, you know, I don't have time to go into that now, but I spent a lot of time in graduate school investigating Bach's performance practices and his dance tempos. And I used to work with a Baroque dancer, so I know firsthand how Baroque tempos are in Bach's mm-hmm. music. Tempo influences articulation, whether it's staccato or legato. So when I perform things by Bach, sometimes I just do things because I like it that way.
Uh-huh.
But I have an informed decision usually also in addition to the fact that I like it that way. So you have to tailor your personal choice based on the way you like it from a subjective point of view. You have to balance that or tailor that with an actual objective investigation into why it should be that way. So most pianists don't really know very little about Bach's dance tempos
mm-hmm.
or the styles that Bach chose and intended for his Baroque dances, which he incorporated into like the well-tempered clavier. Most students and teachers know very little about that. So this is one thing I hope to expound upon in wellroundedpianist.com. I want to offer, you know, tutorials on, you know, how to play a courant or how to play a gigue or how to play an allemande in Bach's music that's not very often talked about by piano teachers.
Mm.
So hopefully I'll get into that. I'll be able to pass my knowledge on to the world in that respect in my new website. So, but I guess just to recap what I just said, you need to balance out your subjective view and what you've been conditioned to learn to hear your whole life
mm-hmm.
and balance that out with the objective point of view of why it should be that way historically. So when I play this fugue, if I do that, and another pianist says, what's he doing? It has to be staccato. What's he doing? He's terrible. He had a bad teacher. He doesn't know what he's doing. Well, how can they say that? Because my decision is informed.
Yeah.
Their decision is just based on what they've heard their whole life.
Yeah.
Because 90% of people play this. See?
Yeah.
In my opinion, that sounds a little bubblegum-ish. I don't know, or if I can think of a better word, that sounds a little on the surface. This sounds a slightly slower speed in legato. Actually, in my opinion, it sounds better. Mm-hmm. It brings more substance to the music. It makes it more vocal in style. And more cantabile, which Bach really liked. Bach strove for a cantabile or a singing style in his music. So if somebody hears me play it that way, they know why I play it that way. I have my reasons.
Mm-hmm.
And Glenn Gould had his reasons. And we all have our reasons, but you need to have a reason. And the reason can simply be because I like it that way. You know,
yeah.
that can be a reason as well. So this is what I love about music is you can line 100 pianists up to play that fugue and you're going to hear it 100 different ways.
Uh-huh.
And there might be out of that 100 pianists, maybe 50 might not be very good. 50 might be good. And out of those good 50, you know, you might have a wide selection of tempos and articulation practices. Yeah. So there's, in other words, there's not just one way to do something. There are many ways of doing something. But I believe my research into Bach's tempos have enlightened me with or given me the information to play Bach's music at the tempo he wanted. So whenever I the tempos I choose for Bach's music is what I believe Bach intended for his music based on my research. Mm. You know, I'm not trying to make anyone play that tempo. When I first came out with my YouTube videos, people thought, you're just trying to make everyone play your tempo. No, I'm not. I'm just sort of just proposing a theory and showing through my research, I believe Bach intended these tempos. Mm-hmm. And these are basic articulations, because often tempo can influence articulation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So if you want to go to BachSholar.com, you can learn about me there, and also my wife, Marilyn, who teaches piano. You can visit the Bach Scholar YouTube channel. Simply put in Bach Scholar on YouTube and go to the channel. And www.wellroundedpianist.com is the site I'm developing right now. It will probably be live in a couple months.
Is there a landing page right now?
No, there isn't. Actually, I have the domain, but I just have a trial. I was trying out a couple different hosts for it.
Okay.
But I do have the domain. I own the domain now, and it's just a matter of pointing to there when I'm all ready. So I'm sort of developing it right now, and it will be ready in a couple months.
Mm.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Well, thank you for coming on the Musical Minds podcast. I definitely got.
You're welcome. I hope this wasn't too long. This is a long podcast.
I'm okay. I got a lot of value out of it, some value bombs, and I actually had never heard you give out your story, and just allowing some of that extra time to kind of let things unfold organically was really pleasant. I don't know if you listen to the Tim Ferriss show. He has really long form interviews, like 3 hours long. So he really lets things just kind of unfold. But so I'm thank you for being generous with your time.
Yeah, you're welcome, Eric. And it's really great to be on your show. And I'm looking forward to hearing it.
Yeah, absolutely. I will. I'll get this up maybe today or tomorrow with editing and everything. And I'll be happy to send it along. I'll upload it to like the SoundCloud, the iTunes, and and YouTube and stuff. So yeah, I'll be happy to send it to you.
Well, thank you. It's been a privilege, and good luck with your podcast.
Thank you.
Okay. Bye.
All right. Bye-bye. All I have to say is, wow, Musical Minds listeners, that was a great podcast with Cory, and there was a lot of value bombs that he dropped. And so I just want to share a couple of them that I got out of the interview. The first is about his new book with sight reading and just sight reading in general. Be honest with your sight reading ability and your ability to learn new music. Have you been investing the time? Have you been investing the energy? And are you at the level that you need to be at as a musician? And he has a great graded level system in his book. You can watch the YouTube video, but it's something that I have really not seen, and I don't have an affiliate or anything. The second thing is, after a certain point of having this standardized level system, you just really have to focus on what's important, which is the music. Do you get as much satisfaction about saying that you are a level 10 music player, or being able to play a very beautiful song and play it with lots of expression? So really focus on the music, focus on the content, and your artistry will shine through much more than just being able to say that you play a level 8 song or something. And the last thing is really with interpretation, have an informed decision and ask yourself, what is it that you want to express? And is it just because your teacher told you to do it, or is it because it's all you've ever heard? Try and search inside your soul and ask yourself, what is the message that you are trying to send? What is the interpretation and the feeling and the emotion that you are trying to communicate with your music? And then finally,
just express it and allow your inner voice, your musical voice, to shine through. And I think people will really resonate with that. So in closing, thank you so much for making it to the end of the interview. I know this was a very long interview. Catch you on Thursday, where I interviewed Jake Pietroniro, my other co-host. You may have been wondering where he's gone, but he's back, and we are going to be talking about perfection and all the things that come up with that. So tune in on Thursday. Look forward to hearing from you guys with a review. Take care and have a great musical Monday. Hello there, it's Eric here. I just wanted to thank you for listening in to the Musical Minds podcast. If you enjoyed this free podcast, would you do me a huge favor and leave an honest review and subscribe to the podcast? It really makes a difference in getting our message visible to musicians in need. Remember, there are so many musicians out there in the world struggling. Always remember, you are not alone. If you're inspired by this podcast and you'd like a free 30-minute intro Skype piano lesson, please contact me directly at musicalmindspodcast@gmail.com. Until next time, continue feeding the fire of your musical passions and developing your musical mind. Take care.